Hello everyone and welcome to the Introduction to Functional Safety for Medical Device webinar. I'm very excited about doing this webinar. I hope you're excited as well. Functional safety is something that everybody's mouth at the moment, everybody's talking about. It's becoming the interesting and important topics for this coming years. First of all, my name is Alberto Padunelli. I'm currently working at TUFSU Product Service as a lead auditor for medical devices in UK. First, about the webinar, it's 45 minutes in length. There are 10 to 15 minutes live question in the end. About the questions, as you know, we are notified body, therefore we cannot provide any consultation. So please, if you have specific questions, technical question about your specific medical device, the only thing I can do is to take the question with me, look, and to try response in regards to requirements, but I will not be providing a solution. Due to confidentiality, you can only see yourself online, but don't worry, I can guarantee there are a lot of you at the moment. This is not an introduction to the 61508 series of standards, which there are 8 parts of the standards, and they are all to do with functional safety. There is no specific standard for a medical device on functional safety, but for example, the 61508 deals with electrical electronic systems, which can be applicable to medical devices as well. Slides will be available at our website in PDF format, and for the same, you will have the question and answer available at our website. Okay, so this is what we are going to discuss for today, meaning of functional safety, just to warm up. I will go into the type of failures that we can encounter during application of functional safety to medical device, and then we will look at some general and specific aspects to consider. Definition. Let's start with the definition. What is functional safety? If we look at the standard part 4, it is defined as part of the overall safety relating to the equipment under control and the equipment under control system that depends on the correct functioning of the electrical, electronic, programmable electronic system, safety related system, and other risk reduction measures. So this is definition directly from the standard. I think what's more important is actually what's the goal of functional safety. And in general terms, the goal is to avoid an hazard caused by malfunctioning of the device. And because of that, it is strictly correlated to risk management. Functional safety relies on active systems. An example is shown here, the detection of smoke by sensor and ensuing intelligent activation of fire suppression system. So because we are prevented of the fire to spread around, then this detection system can be called as active system. And this is what functional safety is all about. If we think active system as proactive, if we go to the reactive, then we are talking about passive system, and we have another example here. This is not functional safety, although if we have, for example, a fire-resistant door that prevents the fire to spread in other rooms, for example, this is still part of a safety-related issue. It is not functional safety, but it is part of safety. In medical device, we have an example for infusion pumps. The main intended use of infusion pumps is to pump fluid. Functional safety considers a different hazard related to, for example, wrong flow rate, wrong volume infused, too many bolus for the patient's control analgesia, reverse flow direction, unintended start or stop of infusion, buildup of excessive pressure, and air infusion, typical normal condition. Okay, these are just some more. If you go into the particular standard for infusion pumps, I'm sure there will be more reference, but this is just to give you an idea what we can look into a medical device for functional safety. Why is it so important? I mean, we do test a medical device in different way, but why is it so important? Why we need to start thinking about this? Because if we go, for example, device directive, and we look at the essential requirements, the next one, we see that we have wording like safety of patients, not to be compromised, We must conform to safety principles, state of the art. So all this really is an indication that we have to look somehow to prevent hazards on the medical device by looking at safety principle. And the medical device directly also give you some indication of what the manufacturer must apply. For example, eliminate or reduce the risk by looking at design and the construction as a first in the order, followed by adequate protection measures. And if that's not enough, then we can have the information to users, which must always be done anyway for medical device. The second one, which is adequate protection measure, is exactly what functional safety is all about. Okay, but as directive states, we should look first into the design and construction. Also, if we look at some standards, the 60601-1, which is the safety and performance of medical system, clause 4.7, 4.7 tell us a little bit about single fault safe, where the risk must remain acceptable through risk management process. And in clause 3.116, we have a definition for the single fault safe or condition, which is a condition which a single means for reducing a risk is defective or a single abnormal condition is present. Again, because of this, functional safety is not only correlated to risk management and the directive, but also to testing standards such as 60601-1. Also, we have other requirements coming from other standards. We have infusion pump standards, dialysis equipment, so we are talking here particular standard. So any particular standard medical device does refers to safety, state of the art, and specific clause will also tell you that we need to prevent hazard in any possible way. Therefore, apply the functional safety to this specific medical device will give us presumption conformity with the directive as well. Not only, but we may have a specific risk assessment defined by you as a legal manufacturer. In this example, I have the monitoring system shall use a communication protocol which is able to detect an interruption in the communication in less than 5 seconds. So this is particular timing. We have 5 seconds is specific. It's come from a risk assessment. So by applying functional safety, we know what to look for here. In principle, what we're trying to do with functional safety is to control failures, which can be either random or systematic. And for the systematic failure, we're trying to avoid them at all cost. Okay, and we try to avoid them by having a strong design development and manufacturing processes. Is functional safety mandatory? Well, looking at the directive for medical device, Article 5.1, it says that, as we all know, if we use harmonized standards, we have a presumption of conformity. However, this means the compliance with the standard is not always mandatory, but at the same time is not always sufficient. Okay, so we cannot just apply the functional safety and say that okay, we are fully conformed to the directive. We can only say that we have a presumption of conformity. We still have to follow in the specific directive. So that was just a warm up, why it's important and what we are trying to achieve with functional safety. We go now into the core of the webinar, which is looking at types of failures. We will see some example of medical device and how we apply functional safety for this medical device. Okay, it's just example, but you can have the concept applicable to other medical devices as well. First of all, as we said before, there are two types of failures. The failures can be either systematic or random. Systematic failures, which are built in design flaws, can be both in hardware or software. Hardware, for example, error in PCB layout. And for this particular failure, we must and can prevent this through a good hardware development process. As an example, you can look at the 60601-1 standard, clause 14, which talks about the programmable electrical medical system. In software, for example, error in specification, code error, or error in the compiler operating system to be used. Here, the likelihood of the occurrence of software failure shall be reduced to an acceptable level through a good software development process. And when we talk about software, pretty much we are talking about the EN62304. It is the life cycle software validation standard. When do we need to avoid these systematic failures? As you remember before, yes, we have random or systematic, but mainly for the systematic, we need to avoid them at all costs. There are a few things we need to remember. First things is the combination of two independent failures shall not be life-threatening. This is taken from one of the standards. Therefore, we need to avoid the control systematic failures, at least if life-threatening. If we look from an hardware perspective, clause 14, this is depending on reliance for essential performance and basic safety. And if we look from a software point of view, it depends from the criticality of the software itself, class A, B, or C. So, what to do against systematic failure? Well, first of all, don't make such failures. Try to have a good measure for failures avoidance, such as design and structural requirement engineering. Okay, it all starts from that. However, you can also detect this failure before production starts if you have a very good verification validation process. If that's not yet enough, then you have to control the consequences of such failures when they occur outside in the field. And this is obviously is going to be most cost effective if you think about it. So the important is to start exactly in the beginning at the design phase and not looking at retrospectively. Let's not forget the V model. This is quite famous graph taken from one of the standards. I'm not going to spend too much time on this. It's basically a model. It's called V because it looks like a V. And it starts from the top left corner. It goes all the way down and then starts from down towards the top right corner. This is a very structural well to validate your PEMs, and the green area is taken from the software standard 62304. That's the validation of the software. So if you put that together, then you have this V model, and it's quite structural. So if you follow this, it will give you a very good idea where to start and where to finish. Okay. This was about systemic failures. Let's look at some random. The random failures, they occur despite correct design and production, okay? It just happened, they are random. They cannot be predicted individually, but only described statistically. For example, short circuits, a relay that's been stuck, and so on. Now, I do agree that we can prevent to have a short circuit, we can do a very good PCB layout and so on. But for example, if the short circuits happen because the component maybe is, you know, stressed electrically or mechanically or something happened, that is something that we didn't include in our design process verification validation. Although we have a good PCB and it's been inspected, we still have this random failure, okay? So nothing, you know, we don't live in a perfect world. Let's put it this way. There are two notes that are very important regarding random. The first one is, if you're talking about software errors, these are always systematic. There is no such as random software error. If the software is stored in an EEPROM, for example, which is a storage medium, and this EEPROM fails, then obviously it is an hardware failure. It's nothing to do with the software. Particularly for operators working in manufacturing environments, operators can have both systematic or random failures. A systematic example, run training. And random could be like an intended action by mistake. So for operator, we can have both a mistake. The things to remember is the random failure must be controlled at runtime by design measures. There are different tests that you can apply. There is redundancy, diversity, and all self-test. We will look specifically at self-test in this webinar, but just so you know, redundancy is where we use the same method twice. That is when we use two different methods with the same functionality. Redundancy test is used to protect only from random hardware failures. Diversity is to protect from both random failures and partly also from systematic failures, depending on how you use this diversity test. To give an idea of diversity, we have a picture here. So two dummies in the same car. This is an example of diversity principle test. Let's look an example, okay? We have an incubator. Obviously, you can see the graph there, but it's very simplistic. It's not exactly a real incubator, but just to give you an idea, we have a generator. They heat up an heater. The temperature raise to keep the baby warm. Now, in this example, which we call a system C, because we have a one control system. There is one switch. The switch is on the heater itself, but when the temperature reach close to 38 degrees, the switch open the circuits and the heater cool down. This is to prevent the temperature to raise over 38 degrees. What can go wrong here? If we look from a risk point of view, well, obviously, in the worst case, the switch doesn't open the circuit. And the heater keeps heating up and the temperature raise, and we have an hazard here for patients. Okay, so let's apply on this functional safety. Yes, we already have a control switch which prevents the heater to heat up, but maybe it's not enough. So let's apply more functional safety and look at the same example more of functional safety. In this case, we have the same circuit, but we have one control system and one protective system. That's why we call this system CP. If the first control system doesn't work, the temperature may be raised until 41 degrees, and I put 41 as an example. You can maybe set to 40, 39, or you know. The switch will interrupt the circuit. It does recognize that there is a failure on the control system and it will open the circuit. Again, we reduce the likelihood that both of the switches don't work. We drastically reduce that, but we do assume, according to the functional safety principle, we do have to assume this and also risk assessment in the worst case. Even if the likelihood is very low, we still have to put some control measure probably. So let's go a little bit. And we have a system CPP, which is one control system, two protective system. It works exactly the same way. If the first one fails, there are two more. If the first two fails, there is the third one. If one of the two switch interrupt don't work, we don't know that they don't work because the control system is working fine. And that's why we call this as a sleeping fault. So there is a fault, but we don't know until the control system doesn't work anymore. Okay, so for this system CPP, the likelihood of the whole three switch don't work at the same times is drastically reduced. We have an happy baby here and everything working fine. But what we need to remember ourselves is that although at first glance this system looks particularly okay from a functional safety point of view, let's think of the timer. What's the time that we need to take from the moment the first control switch doesn't work to the moment the first switch interrupt realize there is a defect, and also from the moment this switch is actually activated? And this example graph shows a fault tolerance time, or FTT. Let's look at the graph. What we have here is, suppose we have the first critical failure. This is the control switch doesn't work. The time that takes from that stop working to the time the first protective system realizes that there is a failure in the system is called detecting failure, or fault detection time according to the standard. So now we know that there is a failure, then the switch interrupts will take action. The time for the switch to take action, it's activating protective measure or fault reaction time. Once the switch interrupt has taken action, the circuit is open, we don't have an hazard for the baby, and we have a safety gap. We have a safety gap before it's too late, before we reach the critical state. The total time here is the fault tolerance time. It needs to be assessed and determined for each of the function, the medical device in your risk assessment. What we're trying to achieve here, looking at the graph, is to have the safety gap as big as possible. In order to do that, we can either reduce the fault reaction time or the fault detection time or both. So if you have the detection time, reaction time in terms of milliseconds, then obviously the safety gap is much larger. Why is it important to have these times so small? Well, let's look at some electric shock with 230 volts. We need this FTT milliseconds. Think about when you're pouring your tea, you're preparing your kettle. If the one of the live wire touch the kettle and you touch the kettle, then you can get electrocuted. But because you have your RCB, your fuse box will take action. Now this all happens in milliseconds. Little bit longer than that and you can be electrocuted and die. So that's what's important. Another example for infusion pumps, again, I'm not gonna go through all the calculation, but the example is on a 1,000 milliliters per hour in single fault condition, and the bolus is 720 milliseconds. What it means is that from the moment the bolus is happening, we have 720 milliseconds to prevent these bolus entering the patients. Is the liver, basically. Another example is their infusion. We have a typical 1 to 5 seconds for the time of an air bubble to travel from the air detector to the cannula. And this, it's large here. We have between 1 and 5 seconds depending on the flow rate, viscosity, density of the fluid, obviously. But these are just some example of fault tolerance time that you need to identify in the risk assessment for each function. If you recall the CPP system, we have one control and two protective system. The FTT talks in regards of the time of the first protective system to be activated. But we have to assume under the functional safety, we have to assume that the first protective system doesn't work either. And so that second protective system must be implemented. Important here is when is a second failure assumed to occur. The shorter a time interval, the more unlikely is the occurrence of two independent random hardware. In poor words, this means that if we have a 5 seconds gap, in 5 seconds, the probability that two random hardware occurs is very low. But if the time is 5 hours or 5 days, obviously the probability is much higher. Okay, so what we can approximate is if we have a time interval delta t, up to a certain limit, the likelihood eta for two independent failures is neglected. Okay, so let's look at the graph. It's exactly as before. We have the first non-critical failure, the failure detection time. Then we know that there is a failure and we have a failure reaction time. Now we reach a safe state. So if now when we reach the safe state, the protective system actually fails, the time to take from the moment to the second independent failure expected, that's the time that we need to calculate. Okay, we call this multiple fault occurrence time, and we need to determine this MFOT for medical device in your risk assessment. So it doesn't have to be for each function, but for the entire medical device. Okay, so how do we do that? Well, probability of second failure. You start with the first fault, then you have to assume that once MFOT has elapsed, a second fault happens. The value of MFOT could theoretically be calculated for each application, but it is rarely done in the medical industry. Although we can look at some standards, and the standard provides with some example. For hemodialysis, we have 1 day. For infusion pumps, if you want to change the disposable, it's typically 1 day, sometimes several days. Okay, it gives us, without the calculation, the math, it gives you some sort of idea what the MFOT is. If before we describe the fact that
Functional safety is strictly correlated to risk management, so the directive, but also is particularly intrinsically connected to the single fault condition, as described in the 60601-1 standard. How do we make then a device compliant with the single fault condition? As explained so far, we have two types of protection. One is on the system level, and on the system level, we can have the CPP system, where a self-test is not necessary, or we can have a CP system, where because we only have one control system, one protective system, we need a self-test of a protective system within MFOT, because we have to identify the second fault can occur if this MFOT times elapsed. Again, the same circuit incubator. This is now the CPP system. This is where the baby was happy, if you remember, okay? So we don't need a self-test because everything at the moment is working fine. We have two protective system, one control system. So we have the first failure can happen in the control system, but this is alarmed by one of the both protective system. Device becomes not usable, it goes to repair. If the failure happens in one of the two protective system, this is not an hazard because the control goes on to control correctly, and even a second P is available. However, we now don't know that the protective system is not working, therefore we call this sleeping fault. In the case of sleeping fault, a second fault has to be assumed after the MFOT. This can occur at the second failure in the other protective system, but again, not an hazard because co the control is working. But if it also happens the second failure in control, then we have an alarm by second protective system. The device is not usable and has to go to repair. Let's look at the CP system. We have one control and we have one independent protective system. In this case, we need a self-test because if the first failure occur in the control, that's okay. We have an alarm about the protective system. Device is not usable, goes to repair. And if the failure happens in the protective system, this is not an hazard because the control is still working fine. We have a sleeping fault of protective system. And in case of this sleeping fault, a second fault has to be assumed after the MFOT. Now we can have a second failure in the P again. This is once again not an hazard because the control working correctly. But if we have a second failure in the control as well, now we don't have the protective system is not working, the control switch is not working, and therefore we have an hazard. This is the reason why we have a self-test of the protective system within MFOT. So once we know what the MFOT is, then we can test accordingly. In this example, we are testing once a day. We are testing basically that the safety switch is working okay. It's all described here. The reason why we don't do a self-test of the control or is not required is because every failure of the control system would lead to an alarm by the protective system. If we look on the component level, okay, then we have the system C. This is the simple system with just the switch, the control switch. As you can see, the hazard here is much riskier, and we have only one control system, which must be associated to a self-test and an external watchdog. A watchdog is what it does. It look for any changes and then apply action accordingly, and that's why it's called watchdog. Okay. So again, what we have here, we have let's look at this graph now. We have a structure C. The first failure can happen in C itself. This is alarmed by the watchdog via the control system because all the components of control system are tested within FTT and the device is not usable repair. So we know that it's not working. However, the watchdog can also fail. If we have a first failure in the watchdog, this is not an hazard at the moment because the control system is working correctly. However, we have a sleeping fault. And if we have a sleeping fault of the watchdog, a second fault has to be assumed after the MFOT. This can occur First, if we have a second failure in the watchdog again, and it is not an hazard because control goes on to control correctly, everything is still working. But if we have also a second failure in control, then this could be a hazard. We don't have a watchdog working, we don't have a control system working. So we have an hazard, and if the obviously because the failure also the watchdog is not detected with before the MFOT. Therefore, we have a self-test of the watchdog within the MFOT. So to put this in poor words, the control system or switch is controlled by the watchdog, and the self-test is controlling the watchdog. And explain here. Again, if we look at infusion pumps as an example, a particular standard, which is the 6601-2-24 for infusion pumps, it will tell you that under single fault condition, you need to have protection from over delivery, from reverse delivery, and from air infusion. I'm gonna go through only the first one, example over delivery. The other two are pretty much very similar. So let's look, how do we protect this from over delivery? A typical solution could be to have a two-channel architecture of the infusion pumps with two microprocessors, one controlling the motor and one supervising the motor. What we need to check is that does the supervisor have its own shutdown path? Are the shared components in the two channels? If the answer is yes, then obviously a single fault will affect both channels. So we have to make sure that there are no too many shared components on the two single channel, but we can divide in two channels. Maybe we have a common voltage regulator, but what happens is that a wrong voltage will bring both microprocessor in undefined state. How do you test this? You can test protective system, two channel system within MFOT. And very similar goes for the protection from reverse delivery and also from air infusion. So there was a little bit introduction on how to look for failures and how to apply functional safety on a very simple example. I took the incubator as an example. Let's look now at some general aspects and also specific aspects to consider for functional safety. The first one is obviously, let's look at the development tools. So when you write a software, you obviously look in some compilers, library. Now, what can be a risk here? The risk, as we call it, a failed scenario, common mode failure, is when you use a compiler, for example, everything all in the software. Now, if this compiler is wrong, everything else goes wrong. And so, the risk of this common mode failure is using the same development tool can create similar malfunctions here. Okay, so perhaps you need to use different library, different compilers, or test the same compiler with self-test system. When we talk about updating of the software, imagine nowadays we have all these medical devices that you can download as a software. Okay, first of all, software update is a device modification, and same rules apply for hardware changes. We must prevent non-authorization of modification. For example, we can have a password or closed casing, and more importantly, there should not be treatment on a patient during this update of the software. Okay. If we have a software through code download, we also have to look that the compatibility check between hardware and software is positive. Okay. We also remember ourselves to update the software either in full or not at all, and not just a part. If we talk about implants, perhaps it's a good idea to store the program first in a protected area, do the update, and then delete the old program once there is a successful check download. We also have to keep in mind the required data parameters must be prevented against overwriting. We need to check for consistency. We need to also make sure the update is done correctly. The update must be documented for each device, of course, for objective evidence. If you update through telephone line or over the internet, this is okay. If the technician is present, I can do the update manually. But what we need to look more is if this update is done remotely. Okay, it is possible but impractical because of different organization, maybe legal issues. We need to be aware of protection against download of non-release software upgrades, protection against remote downloads without of software upgrades without or delayed instruction for use, and so on. So it is possible, but perhaps it's not the easiest viable way to do it. From the general point of view, we need to look against safety. And there are typical failure scenarios that we need to consider. For example, loss of data, like sending all data packets or in the wrong sequence. We can have an unexpected receipt of data or communication between wrong devices. And we can also be aware of transmission electronic viruses. Specific for wireless communication, there is something called wireless coexistence, and this is a key factor which depends from the limited amount of radio frequency spectrum that we have available for all devices. As an example, we have a Bluetooth. The Bluetooth operates in a very small radio frequency spectrum between 2.4 and 2.485 GHz. In order to be effective, the Bluetooth employs three different techniques. I'm not going to go over the techniques, but just so you know, that's how the Bluetooth makes it workable for such a small radio frequency spectrum. And this is what we need to look at when we apply functional safety, obviously. Not only that, but also for wireless communication is the quality of service. We may have connection lost without a warning or failure to establish connection. You know, it happens. And imagine if it's important in a medical device where he has to transfer some important data or alarms, okay? We don't want to lose connection right there. Also, if we have, that could also happen if we have too many device nearby in the same band radio frequency transmitters. Spectrum, so this could increase the latency. And for example, the alarm of an infusion pumps transfer wireless to a data center. It is transferred, but instead of being transferred within a second or no, it transfer after 5 seconds. Obviously, different between 1 second and 5 seconds could be life or death for the patient. Again, for wireless, we need to keep in mind protection against communication between the wrong devices, and this protection is when transmitted data should contain the source and destination address to prevent the following potential hazard situation: wrong source address, wrong destination address, and so on. Example for the Bluetooth, we won't have a data integrity measures for transmitting data packets. Okay. So in poor words, we need to have a correct source and destination address that must be verified by the receiver. Also, we need protection of the human being from excessive radiation. We have radiation coming from this wireless communication, and tests must be done in order to prevent potential risk of cancer, for example. Bluetooth, to keep the same example, a test has been done. We are all okay because up to now the test has been done and it shows no harm from radio frequency levels using the 802.11b and the Bluetooth technology. We are talking very small power here, 1 milliwatts, which will have significantly less power than most transmitter use, like 100 milliwatts. So in the terms of Bluetooth, we are okay. But it is something that we have to be aware when we apply functional safety. Apart from safety, there is also the security, privacy. The specific security and privacy aspect must be considered. Administrative safeguards, physical safeguards, and also technical safeguards, such as password management, information system activity records. And in very basic words, we don't want third people or third person to access or manipulate the message. Okay, so a good encryption and decryption measure must be put in place. Finally, information to the user. If you remember, the directive asks us to do that. So specific information to the user must be considered. And if you look at the 60601-1 standard, this is in clause 14.13. Okay, so this is the end of the webinar. It's a very, very small brief introduction on functional safety, what it is, why it's important, and few examples on how to apply to medical devices. Okay, if you want to know a little bit more, please look at the 61508 series of standard. As a takeaway message, let's remember a few key points. A single functional failure can mean the difference between life and death for patients. Functional safety is an additional step on top of the other traditional testing, okay? It provides ensuring the safety-related system in the device will offer the necessary risk reduction required to minimize the severity and probability of harm in the event of malfunction. The risk analysis, I think we can all agree here, it's a must and strictly correlated to the functional safety of the device. Functional safety covers all life cycle activity from initial conception to implementation. It also approaches specifically used to concept of the single flaw condition and self-test that must be in place to guarantee the device remains single flaw safe. Functional safety has to treat the function of a component or subsystem as part of the function of the whole system. Methods used have to be extended to every part of the device itself, actuators, controls, switch, monitors, and so on. Self-tests are key for the medical device to remain single flaw safe during its expected service life. The requirement for self-test is dependent on the protection type available for a particular fault. The plan to implement the functional safety should be first functional safety analysis, where the objective is to analyze and identify the hazards that may arise if the essential performance is not met, followed by the device architecture generation, where you identify the device safety requirements and system architecture. And finally, single fault condition test, where you test for failures and protection against them. This will be the top level plan to follow. If you want to learn more about it, TÜV SÜD UK provides in-house and public training course on the following. I'm particularly the trainer for Medical Device Directive, the 1345, the 1471 Risk Management, 9001. We also have expert in-house to train, provide training on microbiology sterilization. And at the moment, I'm personally working on functional safety for medical device. It's such important at the moment that I would like to provide the training public and in-house. And the new standard coming up, ISO 9001:2015. Okay, this is the end of our webinar. Thank you very much. I hope you enjoyed. We will now go for 10-15 minutes of last questions. Again, the PDF PowerPoints and of the webinar and also quality question and answers will be provided on our website. So go to our website and you will find everything there. Thank you very much for listening.